glad to be able to serve Him and worship Him. I know I've said that several times, but I'm not ashamed. I'm glad that this is Sunday. I'm glad it's not Monday. I'm looking forward to tomorrow. Tomorrow starts our youth camps for the state of Indiana. We're glad to see the students who are going to get there and get excited and be blessed. And if anybody wants to come out and visit the service on Monday night through Thursday night at 7 o'clock in prayer line, you're allowed to do that. You just got to sign in and be blessed and see how the students worship and give their all they've got to the Lord Jesus Christ. But right now, our attention needs to be on Him and His Word and what He wants to do for us at this moment. Amen. What He wants to do right now for us, He has a plan and He has a purpose. So this morning I want to preach on, don't let the blessing be cursed. Say it with me. Don't let the blessing be cursed. Our foundation scriptures will be Psalm chapter 127, verse 3. It says, behold, the children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Now, this is not just a message for those who have children. I want you to hear the heart of this message this morning about children. Children are a heritage. They're a blessing. Can you say the children are a blessing? Children this morning here were a blessing. And there's many more. On Wednesday nights, you'll be thrilled sometimes to see how many come through. You're like, where do all these kids come from? I've not seen their parents. I'm expecting their parents to follow in one day. Amen. We're proclaiming that. Amen. That we're investing right now to the lives of children, that their parents are going to see a difference and they're going to be like, what happened to little Johnny?
Right.
What took place? And he used to talk back, but now he's quiet and listening and saying, yes, ma'am, yes, sir, whatever you need. And what's happened? Christ is in my life. Has anybody been changed by the blood of Jesus Christ? Hopefully you respond different than you used to, right? So I'm glad that we're able to minister to these children. I want us to go to Matthew chapter 19. Sorry, verse 13. It says, then little children were brought to him that he might put his hand on them and pray. This is talking about Jesus. The people were bringing their children to Jesus that he might lay their hand, that he might lay his hands on them to pray. They realized that the children's lives need the touch of Jesus. Our children, the ones that are in your household, need a touch of Jesus.
Amen.
My three children need a touch of Jesus. Your children need a touch of Jesus. Our kids who come to the church need a touch of Jesus. And more important, I need the touch of Jesus. You need the touch of Jesus. And they recognize there's something about the touch of Jesus. There's something about being comforted. Has anybody ever needed to be touched before? You just need someone to put their arm around your shoulder and say, it's going to be okay? To encourage you, to bless you, to strengthen you, that our children don't need to be put down all the time. They need to be lifted up and exhorted. Not always telling them that, hey, you're doing this wrong and doing that wrong. We need to exalt them and what they're doing right. We need to commend them and bless them. They need to feel our touch. Now, I know we've got to be careful in the day that we're in. Now, I don't want to get any parents mad, and I'm careful. I don't hug them too much, but I always give them a high five. I think they like that better. They like fist bumps and elbow bumps. I elbow bump. Why? Because no one else is doing it. I'm starting a new trend. I elbow bump. And they're like, what are you doing? I'm like, come on. No, elbow bump me. I've got some handshakes with some that I can't always remember, but we make up stuff. And it's like we're touching them. You need to touch them. It can't just be the children, pastors. It can't just be us. Every one of us has to touch these children at a young age and our students. Our students like to be touched. They like the interaction. They like knowing that they're loved. I mean, loves our students. We have a great representation this morning. And if you're 18 years and under, I want you to stand up. We're going to do this for you. I want you to stand. If you're under 18, even if you're visiting for the first time, yeah, don't be ashamed. Michael, I call people out. Just be ready. Everybody say hi to Michael. You just needed that this morning. But look at this. Isn't this awesome? They're in the back dancing. But we need our students to know you can sit down. They need their love. This is what is happening here. They need Jesus needed a touch of it. The disciples, because they were trying to protect Jesus, they're like, I know he's tired, he's wore up, but you know, they were trying to keep him away, and Jesus says, no. Verse 14, let the little children come to me. And do not forbid them, for such is the kingdom of heaven. You He's going to use these children later on. He's going to show an example that this is what is the kingdom of heaven. These who are like childlike faith. And it says he laid his hands on them. He prayed for them, and then he departed to another place. Jesus wasn't afraid to touch them and pray for them. We can't be afraid, church. We've got to embrace our youth. They need to hear the love of Christ. Just as every age group does. This is not against the senior adults. If you're over 18, this message is still for you. Hold on. But we have an important part to play in the upbringing and the training of youth, young adults,
that's right,
middle-aged adults, anyone who comes into faith that didn't grow up in church, they need somebody to embrace them because they're not getting it in the world. They're not getting the affirmation. They're not getting the love. They may get some pats on the back, but they walk away. Was that real, or is that they want something from it? So we need to love the ones here in this church, not expecting anything from them. We don't want them to think that we're just trying to love them to get something from them. They need to know that they're loved because they're a part of the kingdom of God. We are to love one another. I think the Bible says that Jesus said, you know that these are my disciples because of the way that they had love for one another. We need to love every age group, and we need to make sure our children are loved. In Judges chapter 2, and this is where the heart of the message is at this morning. I want you to understand what's going on here. I don't have time to go through all the book of Judges, but I want to look at just a few scriptures here that to me sadden my heart when I read this. But look what goes on starting in verse 7. Now, to set this up, this is, you know, after the people have been freed from Egyptian bondage or the Roman, Moses is already gone, Joshua's on the scene, and so the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua. In all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord which he had done for Israel. Now Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died when he was 110 years old. And they buried him in the border of his inheritance at Timnath-Heres in the mountain of Ephraim on the side of the Mount Gaash. When all the generations, look at this verse, have been gathered to the fathers. What that means is when all the generations died, they were gathered to the fathers, they were laid to rest. The early generations that saw all these great works of the Lord, when they were gathered to the fathers, when they died, another generation arose. How many knows there's always going to be another generation to follow? And some of us look back and we look down at the next generation like, I just don't understand that generation. And that generation looks at us like, I don't understand that generation. Anybody been in those conversations and experienced those things that we just don't quite understand? But here's the sad thing. That generation arose who did not know the Lord, nor the work which he had done for Israel. The younger generation grew up and they didn't know the work, what the Lord had done for the people of Israel. They don't remember. They didn't know the miracles that took place. You may be asking, what kind of works? And I mentioned one to you, the work of deliverance. You remember the story of the Red Sea? Do you remember when God set the people free from the Egyptian bondage and they drove out of Egypt, taking some things from them, and they went to the edge of the Red Sea, what stopped them from going on? And they're like, why did you bring us out here in the desert? They were in bondage. The people of Israel were held captive. They were slaves. They were workers, and they couldn't get anything fair done for them. And so God had compassion on the people of Israel. He raised up Moses to be their leader so they could be set free to get them out of that bondage. And when they came to the Red Sea, you know the story, that Moses listened to God. He responded to the voice of the Lord. And out of obedience, he threw the staff out, and the sea opened up. Anybody recall that story? What a great miracle. And I'm not preaching on the Red Sea, but I'm just remembering what took place. What a miracle. I mean, I don't think I could help and tell everybody what happened. I mean, look, I was there. I mean, I was at the edge of this riverbank, and I was like, how are we going to get across? It's too deep. It's too fast. I can't get through this. We can't go backwards. They're heading towards us. The army is fierce. They're on their way. We have no place to go. What are we going to do? And out of obedience, Moses listens to the voice of God, and the Red Sea is split. You split the sea so I can walk through it. Amen. Is there any seas in your life that you had and needed opened up? Is there anything that was closed? You're like, God, I can't go forward and I can't go backward. Without you, I can't. I'm just stuck. And I know if I stay here, I'm going to be destroyed. I need you to open up the sea that's blocking. Can anybody testify of that this morning? That there may have been something. It may have been health. It may be a relationship. It may be according to your job. Whatever it is, no matter what that sea is, we have the power of God within us. We can speak to the problem. Let this mountain be moved. Let these seas be opened. God has all authority in our life. When we surrender to Him, He opens up the sea. And here's what their children did. They walked across on dry land. But the story didn't get passed down. The generation didn't know the works. That's what this, am I reading that right? They did not know the Lord, nor the works was He had done for Israel. A younger generation rose up and they didn't know the Lord or the works. What other works are we talking about? We can list a lot of stories, but I remember the walls of Jericho, Joshua chapter 6. You remember that story, right? We all learned it as little kids. We assumed that. Because when we make those statements, we're assuming that everybody's in children's church. It's not always the case. There are people who are biblically illiterate when they're 40 years old. That walls of Jericho, what are you talking about? Three Hebrew children burning in a fire, what are you talking about? I love my high. I have to say, we had hot dogs yesterday, Hebrew Nationals. And I always say, I love these because you put them in the fire, they don't burn. Anyway, that's... Some of you will get it later on. But we assume that everybody knows these stories as children, right? We've got to teach them. They got to say, so the walls of Jericho, a powerful story where God is saying, we're giving you the victory over the city because God gave them the land, but there's a city that they haven't taken yet that God wanted to have, and it was surrounded by a wall. They couldn't get through the wall. But God says to Joshua, here's what I want you to do. I want you to march around the wall one time a day. Now I want you to let the army go out, and after them I want you, the worshipers, the priests to go out and blow the trumpet, and I want the people to follow and walk around this wall one time a day. And on the seventh day, I want you to do it seven times. So when Joshua is sharing this, how we're to take over the city, he tells the people, I don't want you to say anything while we're marching. I find that so important. Because I can tell you what probably would have been said if they were allowed to talk while they were marching. Why are we marching? Why are we doing it this way? Why aren't we doing it that way? Why did we change this? And why can't we do that? Does anybody know what I'm saying? Instead of just marching in obedience to see the victory take place, we're always grumbling and complaining because it's not what I understand. It's not what I want. It's not what I need because it's about me. No, it's about Jesus. I need to listen to His voice and follow His voice. But I know this, when I see the story of what took place, and well, there's so much in that story I'm not going to preach it all this morning. But you know, on the seventh day they got up and they marched around seven times and they blew the trumpets. They shouted. Here's what they happens at the end. And Joshua says to the people, after the seventh time, I want you to shout with triumph. I want you to shout with victory. Can we do that right now? Does anybody say, just shout to the Lord. Hallelujah! I'm saying, give Him praise right now. Shout to the Lord. Hallelujah! Glory to the Lord. He's brought His victory. I'm no longer a slave to sin. I'm no longer bound to fear. I've been set free. I've been redeemed. I want others to know the story. I want my children to know the story. I've got to pass it on. You may not have physical children, but the children of this church and the youth of this church need to know your story. They need to know how you've been set free by the blood of Jesus Christ. Maybe you're already grown and your children are grown and they're not here, but you need to have an investment in the children of this church and the youth of this church. They need to hear the victories. That's such a sad verse when we see the generation did not know the Lord or what the Lord had done for them. Does anybody have a victory story that's worth sharing? That someone could be strengthened by, whether an adult or a student or a child. We can't hold up our stories. We've got to share. That's why it's important we make connections in small groups and classes and different places. We're able to share our stories. There are sometimes we allow people to give testimony here, and I like that. I like knowing people. And we went through a season and we let several people share their 3-minute testimony that turned into 5, 10, 15. You know how that works. Because there's so much to share, right? Right, Brother Andy? I know you're like, we couldn't get the mic away from Brother Andy. He was testifying, this is what God did in my life. I'm not ashamed. I want people to know me. He's changed me. He's transformed me. There's life in him. And this is what is so sad that this generation didn't know. Please, God, help us not be a church that doesn't let the younger generation know of the power of God. Anybody know about the power of the Holy Spirit? I'm glad we're a Pentecostal church. I'm not ashamed. I don't want to be out of control. I want to be in control, but I want God to have control. I want God to have his way. So if someone feels like the Lord moves on them, they begin to start to dance or leap or whatever you call it, the jig or jug or whatever it is, let God have his way, but do it in order. But we're giving God the praise. If someone shouts, it's out of nowhere, or a message comes, we're open for the moving of the Spirit when it's all about him. I believe in the power of Pentecost. And I'm going to share, I'm glad to see Brother Daniel this morning. The first time he visited us was the day before, or the week before Pentecost Sunday. If he doesn't mind me sharing, do this. Thank you. If he doesn't mind me sharing, that Sunday he was talking to my wife, visiting. He says, well, I'm just kind of looking around for a church, and I was going to go someplace else next week to check it out. But he says, after I heard that you're going to preach on Pentecost, we were already preaching on Pentecost, and it's Pentecost Sunday, and the way that you talked about it, like it was going to be such a great day, I don't think I can miss. Guess where Daniel was on Sunday morning, Pentecost Sunday? Right there. Amen? Because there's something about the power of God that draws me. It's not just about his power, it's him. But he wants to fill us so we can be used. And I'm not going to preach Pentecost, but you know that we believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, not just for the manifestations, but that we might be witnesses. That's what the scripture says. So I can testify about the goodness of Jesus Christ. So the walls, the victories. But they didn't know these stories. How important it is, our children, they have to see us worship. And I know that they're in children's church, and yeah, it is kind of a different day, and we're looking at Sunday nights what to do. We have different small groups, and we have a great prayer meeting. Again, usually the first Sunday of the month, watch your calendars, but usually the first Sunday night we have a prayer meeting. This next week is not going to be one. Most of our folks are going to be done, so we're not going to have it next Sunday night. But know this, when we pray, we just say come in here and find a place to pray for 30 minutes or an hour. We are interactive together, seeking God. We worship, we sing, we praise the Lord. It's a service. And I miss some Sunday night service atmosphere. We've talked about this many times. Some of the best services I've been in has been on a Sunday night. People are not so worried about spaghetti. Their mind is on, I want to have God. I'm ready to feel him. I'm ready to touch him. I'm ready to enter in. And it's a different atmosphere. But here's the thing. In those Sunday night services, we didn't offer children's church. We did on Sunday morning. But Sunday night we did. We want the kids to be in there. We want them to see us praise. Yes, they're watching you. So if you're like this, guess what they're going to do? If you're like this, guess what they're going to do? They're going to mimic us. Whether they understand or not, they're going to do what we're going to do. Little Hannah, the one who's sitting up, standing up front, they're all cute. The little cute one, I taught her a couple months ago. I said, you know what, David? You know, I said, just say pastor. Every time she sees, hey, pastor. I love it. And it's terrible. Oh, get that tear up. But just a few weeks ago, we were hanging out here, and someone working throughout the day on Sunday, and she was just rolling home. You know that when we have the right atmosphere, people want to come and hang out. Some of these kids, they just want to come and hang out. Nothing wrong with humbling. I just want to be in church. I remember growing up, I love being in church. There's something about being in the building, right, being on the property. Church is a good place to be. She was just hanging out, and they were working on the, she was mimicking the youth group's dance and showing how they did the dance. It was just, the song was in her head. It was amazing. They need to see from us worship. I know you've heard me say this before, but we've got, we're worshiping God, but we have to be involved in the worship. Every one of you are called to be a worshiper. To shout, to sing, to lift your hands, whatever it is, be comfortable, but stretch yourself too. You won't break. He'll receive the praise. He deserves the praise. Amen? All right, let's go back to Matthew chapter 18. Talking about Jesus, says at that time the disciples came to Jesus saying, who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Anybody ever been in those kind of discussions? Who's best? Who's better? It happened. There's nothing new. The disciples were like that. They were asking, who's better? Who's the best? And Jesus called a little child to him. He set them in the midst of them. And he said, assuredly, I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. That's a powerful statement. What an illustration. Jesus finds a little child, brings him in the middle. Unless you become like him. Unless you become like her. Unless you become like little Hannah. You don't care. You're ready just to worship God. You'll do the movements that you're being taught. You'll raise your hand, you'll dance, you'll sing, you'll do whatever, because kids do things. Hey, whatever they're asked, oh, hey, can we have a volunteer? How many hands go up? Every one of them, right? I want to do it. Adulterers, need a volunteer. He's talking to you. Isn't that right? Jesus said we need to become like little children. We need to get back to the mind. I want to. Pick me. We don't do that anymore because we get our feelings too hurt if we don't do it. Being serious, right? I deal with this. For the first time in so many years, I'm not officially working youth camp. And crushed. I was sneaking in anyway. But I had to do it. And this morning, I was getting ready. I was like, you know what? I need to make room for others to be able to step up and do what I've done, because I've been blessed over these years. I love being around the students. And you know, but if I'm there and I'm keeping someone else from coming in to be able to serve in that position, shame on me. Be selfish. I want some of these younger people who are just now getting in church and they're at that age where they want to commit to the Lord. It may be an event like that that gets them connected with other people in the kingdom of God that keeps them connected to the church. So I can go and show up and leave and go back at the end of the week. I can do those things. I want God to touch the lives, and He has everything in order if we're willing just to surrender. You know, we get in the way of a lot of things, don't we? Because our selfishness, our pride. And it doesn't mean those things are wrong in the things that we want to do, but sometimes we don't look at the bigger picture. What happens if I get out of the way? Now, this does not mean for every one of you who have a position that you come to me after church and I'm quitting. That's not saying. That's not what we're. I want somebody else to have a place. No, no. You stay until I say, hey, I think so-and-so would be great at this, and I think you would do great at this. And you're like, you know what? That would be a great idea. It may be different for me, but I would be glad to serve wherever I'm needed. Can everybody say, I'll do that?
Yeah.
All right. Some of you agree. All right. But this is what verse 4 and 5 says. Therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom. Whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. How many wants to see Christ? What's in the center of your life? It's about coming to Him in childlike faith. It's about not shunning away anyone, but realizing they are a soul. Sometimes they may be hard to deal with. Anybody know some difficult people?
Yeah. That's the only amen I got.
Sometimes it's hard to deal with people. I'm challenged by it. Because in the flesh I want to say this, but I know in the spirit I need to say that. The scripture we was looking at this morning in our discipleship class is talking about living peaceful among all men. We've got to have unity. We have peace, the peace of God. We've got to strive for it. We've got to make an effort. The ones who are saved, we can't blame the ones who are not saved. They're not saved. They're sin. Sin controls them. They're not going to respond the right way. We, even though we don't want to admit it, we have a responsibility to respond differently. We allow the fruit of the Spirit to reign in us. Because we've got to be like a little child. As little children, you can push them away and you can say, get out of it. And they think you're joking, so what do? Come back, right? And they climb on you even harder. No, get off of me. No, that means get on your head. You know, they climb on top of you, right? That's what Christ wants us to do as little children. We just keep the innocence. Don't let hurt and offense drive you away. Don't let it build a wall. Any wall that is built can come down like Jericho. We can have victories. I want you to hear this last statement here. Let's see our children and the children the Lord send our way rise. You may not realize this, but our children's ministry is called Rise. Our youth ministry is called Stand. The children's ministry says we want our children to rise so they can stand. So we need to pray this. Say it out loud. Let's see our children and the children the Lord sends our way rise. It's got to be a prayer. We've got to be intentional about it. We want to see them rise. We have a purpose. Every one of us can make an impact, a positive, negative, on anyone that comes in this building. So that's why it's so important that we are walking with the Lord. Each one of us. Walking in righteousness. Walking in holiness. Walking in sincerity. Walking humbly. Not walking in pride and conceit and boastfulness, but being open for God to use us humble. So God at any moment can speak through us and touch somebody. To be aware. Lord, open our eyes. Open our eyes to see what people are going through. We don't have to need to know the details, but if someone is hurting, let's just see what that they need to be comforted. You ever been there where you were going through something and you were trying your best not to show it? You don't want to come in looking mopey. That's not the idea. But there's sometimes the Lord can just put on someone's heart like, we're going through something. I don't want to embarrass them. I don't want to call them out. They may be around the altar, maybe in a small corner or whatever, maybe shaking hands. They may just need to hear, you know what, I'm praying for you. The Lord just wants me to let you know I'm praying. That may be all that needs to be said. They may not go into discourse. They may not need to tell you all the details. You don't need to ask all the details. What are you going through? Just say, I'm here for you. If you need me, you can call me. I love you as a brother and sister in Christ. I want to see God do great things. And no matter what you're going through, He can split the sea. The musicians come back. He can split the sea. He can take away the fear. He can take away the anxiety. He knows us. He's called us. You stand at your feet, listen to this. He knows you by name. He knows where you are right now. The place you are is not an accident. The Lord directs your steps. You may be wondering, how did I get to this place at this time in my life? I didn't see this happening 20 years ago. I didn't see this happening 5 years ago. I don't know why I'm at this place in my life. If the Lord has not left you, He hasn't forsaken you, but he is with you. He will take you in his hands. He will guide you, and he will keep you. As we begin to sing this out, I just want to open the altars so you can just pray and respond to the word. Let the Lord touch your heart and say, God, I just need you. Feel your touch. That may be your prayer this morning. No matter what it is, you need to respond to the word. Let God move on your heart. From my mother's womb, you have chosen.